What's up, everybody, and welcome to episode 79 of the ChumpCast. This week, we get to talk about the long-awaited release of Marvel's Black Panther. We also speculate about time travelers, sexy ghosts, and listen to Mark's review of the Paddington Bear franchise. We need more bad bets for your entertainment, so call us with your best ideas. Could be a bad movie suggestion, a competition, or even just a stupid wager. Leave us a message at 847-920-6107, even if you just want to call and say hi. If you want to support the show, you can rate us on Apple Podcasts or tell a friend. We have merch available for sale at thechumpcast.com, or you can shop through our Amazon affiliate link at thechumpcast.com/Amazon. Now, excuse me while I go wait by the phone for your calls.
I don't like that you guys are sitting up higher than I am.
I do. There's a power move.
I bet you do.
We're in the position of power. We're looking down upon you. We're lording over you right now, actually.
How is that any different than any other situation?
True. We always look down upon you.
You just, like, short people love this.
The hiding chair?
Yeah. Sitting up higher than me?
I don't think short people like sitting up in high chairs.
Yes, they do.
Their feet dangling down.
Do your feet touch the ground?
Sitting on this chair you have?
Just barely.
Barely.
Mine do not.
If the heels aren't touching the ground, technically, I don't even consider them.
Erica's feet dangle like a little kid on a ski lift.
Yeah.
So I went to Emporium yesterday after we went to that Kaiser Locks place, Kaiser Tiger.
You went where? Emporium?
Emporium.
The arcade bar?
The arcade bar. And they have that Michael Jackson game.
Moonwalker?
Michael Jackson Moonwalker.
Yeah.
That game's hilarious. The first time I played it was with Ilpo, and he had it on his Xbox that, like, you can, like, take all these emulators and stuff. That game is ridiculous. Michael Jackson has, you're doing dance moves and beating up mobsters that have captured little children, and you're releasing the children. And
are you releasing them, though?
Yeah. They're like, oh, Michael. They run towards you and then, like, exit the level.
Or
and
are that, they just it, changing hands?
After you win, after you win the whole game, Michael Jackson turns into an aircraft and flies off the screen. Game over. Michael Jackson, Moonwalker.
I don't know what's weird about that.
That seems intense.
It was a thrill ride. I'm telling you. Thrill ride. So use all your quarters there.
So what is this place called? Emporium?
Yeah.
What's that over in Wicker Park?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's a really cool place. Very retro feeling.
We played Blitz. We had NBA Jams. Chris and I were gaming hard. Killer Instinct out there. Mortal Kombat.
Hot take. Killer Instinct was better than Mortal Kombat. So it came out around the time that Mortal Kombat 3 came out. And by then, Mortal Kombat was kind of declining a little bit.
Dude, they have great characters. Spinal, that guy with, like, he's like just a freaking skeleton with a sword and a fire sword.
Cinder was my go-to.
Cinder. There was, like, a saber wolf.
Yeah. Then they tried to re-release that on Xbox One and it wasn't.
It was good. A free-to-play.
Yeah, it wasn't good.
It was okay. The graphics were, like, sick.
There's a lot of those places in Chicago. What is the one in River North? I was just there last Sunday. Headquarters.
And there used to be one over here called Headquarters, but it changed and now I don't know what it's called. And there's actually one in Boys Town, too. Which has, like, the stairway on the back, the fire exit, looks like the original Donkey Kong.
Sick.
You know, like, you climb up the
I think I've seen that then. Yeah. That's super cool, actually. What a great design.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
When I was at Headquarters, I was playing, two main games I was playing were Tekken Arcade. So you had, like, the joystick and everything, which is great.
Yeah,
I was playing
the best way to do it.
Playing as Law, the greatest character, when he does the backflip kick. And then the other one was, what is the co-op shooting game that was huge for, like, movie theaters and stuff? You'd always see them at movie theaters.
Oh, where you hold the actual gun?
Yeah.
Should I know?
Don't remember. I know exactly what you're talking about.
TJ's like, you never played this game? Like, this was my childhood growing up and going to movie theaters.
Dude, like Time Crisis?
Time Crisis.
But that was the Jean-Claude Van Damme movie.
We were playing Time Crisis. And the thing is, Emporium probably, you just pay to get in and it's unlimited games, right?
No, it's you got to buy quarters of change.
Oh, really?
Which,
yeah, some of them are different. Like the one over here.
Headquarters, you don't. You just have unlimited gameplay.
That's a way better strategy.
But they're like, I'm sure they make up for it in their drink prices and shit like that.
True.
Me and TJ were playing and we were beating Head Crisis. We were at, like, the last level of the game. The kid probably was his first time there. He's like, wow, you guys are really good. Little did he know we had unlimited lives because you don't have to keep feeding
just
quarters.
Press the button again.
Yeah.
Damn, you guys are slaying out there. Yeah. Making Time Crisis your crisis. Never mind. All right.
why are we talking about this? I don't remember.
I just brought up gaming because that's just what I do, man.
Yeah, why did you go to Emporium? I thought you were going to go home. I'm pissed now I didn't go with you guys.
Yeah. Well, first of all.
No, I said we said we're going to Wicker Park.
And you guys hung out and just
I thought that meant, like, go back home.
Yeah, no. Yeah, no, that's we
went to Emporium.
Emporium, yeah. Clear miscommunication there.
Thanks apparently. For the invite, guys.
Yeah, no problem. I actually, it was Zahos. You talked to Zahos. I just tagged.
That is the most negative thing I'm going to say this entire podcast. I'm turning over new leaf. I'm going to try and be positive.
We like the outlook, but it's not going to happen. But we like the outlook, though.
Yeah, and it's probably not going to happen because of you guys.
You're saying sure negative.
I'm already going negative. Exactly. Already going. All right, let's talk about some news this week, yeah?
Yes.
I was flipping through some headline articles, and I saw something on the Wall Street Journal. There was a book that came out that kind of detailed how the Marvel Universe got started, the MCU. And it came out that Sony could have bought nearly every Marvel character when they made the Spider-Man deal back in the late 90s. They could have bought all of them for $25 million.
Holy shit.
So this Sony exec says, nobody gives a shit about any of the other characters. Go back and get Spider-Man. We're about $10 billion later now.
Oh.
Somebody should probably get fired for that.
It's kind of true, though. Spider-Man. Back around that time, nobody really gave a shit about anyone other than Spider-Man.
I mean, none of it really mattered until Iron Man came out in 2008.
Yeah. True.
Spider-Man was owning the Marvel Universe after the Tobey Maguire movies were coming out. There wasn't much other than that.
They had the games were sick too.
Yep. Yeah. Those Tobey Maguire movies are vastly underrated. They're not bad. The third one is very corny.
Dude, when he's like cringy. Walking around like a little psycho Venom loser around town.
Look
at my attitude. I'm so swinger now. Wow.
And also he's like 30, 35 and trying to play an 18-year-old.
Yep.
Yeah. Not great. But the first two are awesome.
Yeah, dude. I saw the Venom preview in theaters. That movie looks incredible. The way I look at it.
What about that trailer made you look and think that was incredible?
Because I just thought of Tommy from Warrior being taken over by the Venom curse and being a badass Venom.
There was nothing in that trailer.
Exactly. Less is more. That's why I like trailers with less. I don't want to see what's going on. Just let me know what's going to be dope. And that means Tom Hardy being Tommy from the Warrior as Venom.
So. I would have been much more satisfied if they would have just gave us a quick little glimpse in the last 2 seconds of the trailer.
Yeah, you got to see the symbiote.
Nope.
I just want to see. They're probably not even done with the effects for it. I don't think it comes out till October, but
it's late.
Look, I'm going to be. I'm going to go see it. I'm a huge Spider-Man fan.
Yeah. Do you think Tom Holland makes an appearance?
He was on set, so
spoiler alert.
I think you pretty much have to. Like, even if it's just you have to set up that they're in the same universe.
Yeah,
agreed.
Because the whole idea is that's where Venom. That's what Venom models his powers after. So it wouldn't make any sense for him to show up and like, oh, he shoots webs.
Well, this is kind of pretty crazy. Yeah. No, what a coincidence.
Yeah. I just thought this was interesting because, well, first of all, it was a huge misstep. But also, if Sony was making these movies, do we have the same universe that we have now? Or were they just shittier movies? Does Jon Favreau come in and do an Iron Man? Or maybe they take it a different direction and we don't even have what we have today.
Yeah, I don't know. That's hard to say.
Well, if they didn't believe in the product, no way.
Yeah, you're probably right about that.
If they were like, oh, well, these things suck anyway. Why are we going to put $10 million into this movie called Iron Man?
Yeah.
Stupid.
Whatever. They still made a shit ton of money with those Spider-Man movies, though.
Spider-Man's... I'm going to buy a PlayStation 4 because I want to play the Spider-Man game so badly. That game looks
so bad.
Incredible.
For some reason, they're still making Karate Kid properties. And did you guys see the trailer for the new YouTube Red series?
No.
I don't get this.
I can't get into a YouTube Red series, to be honest.
I mean,
I don't know.
Something about a YouTube. Same.
Do you know anybody that has a YouTube Red subscription?
No. Or like the Facebook. No. Facebook is doing shows now, too. There's one with LeVar Ball.
That's true.
Ball in the Family, I think it's called.
Ball in the Family.
Oh, my God.
You've never seen the commercials for that?
No.
On Facebook?
Thankfully. Yeah.
I should probably delete my Facebook.
I try to use it as little as possible. It's just toxic and terrible.
Nothing beneficial comes out of Facebook for me.
Except for the ChumpCast. Follow us. Yeah, like, or delete your everything.
Half the time, I'm scrolling through and seeing people's opinions and just getting extremely upset.
You're just following the wrong people, literally. Yeah. Follow only game weird things and funny people.
The people that are loudest are the people with the worst opinions.
Just unfollow me.
You can literally direct at who you want to look at.
But the more... like pragmatic person would think, do I need to post this on social media? As opposed to the person that's like, oh, everybody needs to know what I think about gun control.
Yep.
I don't remember how we got into this, but I'm going to move on. We got a real trailer for The Incredibles 2.
We should call him Ryan Leaf because he's turning over a new leaf. And Ryan Leaf sucks ass, though.
This is why I end up negative all the time.
All right, Leaf, let's go.
Anyways.
Let's leave it at that.
Oh my God, amazing.
Leave. Get out. The Incredibles 2 trailer. This looks awesome. It's behind Avengers. This is probably one of my most anticipated movies of the year.
Well,
I'm going to go to that movie and go up to a little kid and be like, why are you here? This isn't your movie.
This isn't for you.
You don't even understand this universe, piece of shit.
It's like all those people that were claiming, the white people that showed up at Black Panther screenings, claiming that black people assaulted them.
Oh, God.
You just go there and beat up some kids. That's the dumbest thing ever, by the way. The fact, like, if you don't want to see the movie, don't see the movie. But to try to draw attention to yourself in a dumb way like that.
Wait, I'm kind of confused. Wait,
people on Twitter were either using makeup or giving themselves black eyes or whatever and saying that they were at a movie. They went to go see Black Panther and people were attacking them. Black people were attacking them.
Why would you do that?
That's the dumbest thing I've ever heard.
Because they want, I don't know, because they're idiots. Yeah. Story time. I went to see Black Panther. Two black girls were sitting in my seat. They were very polite and offered to move. And I was like, no, that's okay. I'll sit where your seat was.
Was it a better seat?
Yeah, kind of. But they were already settled in. Like they had their popcorn and shit.
Yeah.
I mean,
I'll admit this. I took the handicap seat. You know, you get the disclosure when you're buying the ticket online.
What are you giggling about?
We could cut this later, but I was just like, you don't want like a Rosa Parks situation. You're the only white guy at the theater. Yeah. Just like, get out of my seat at the Black Panther release. And I like was giggling because I was like, should I say this? This
is kind of sit in the back of the theater.
I go back to your seat and I just, we can cut that and post it.
I'm sorry, continue.
What was I saying?
You sat in a handicap seat because you're a terrible person?
Sorry, it's pretty much. Yeah, so
I'm in the same theater.
I took the handicap seat, which was actually really clutch. It was literally right when you walked in, it was right around the corner against the wall that is like covering the stairs where people go up. So you don't see anybody.
Yeah.
Which is great. <That's> right. You don't have to deal with anybody. You don't have to look at anyone.
It's pretty clutch.
You definitely, if you ever want to risk taking those seats, you know, you get the disclosure when you buy it saying, there's somebody that needs this accessibility and needs it for their wheelchair or whatever. You have to get up and move. You're taking that risk, but I'm going to keep doing it it was great.
It's like going to the bathroom in the handicap stall and then just like Larry David walking out and still, why in that one?
Peter Dinklage just standing there.
But my point is, those seats are prime for people just sitting in them, even though they're not their seat. I got dropped off like half an hour early because I was just out and I didn't want to go back home and go back out. I was sitting there like before anyone was getting there and people were just sitting in those seats and I'm like, oh God.
Did you walk up with a limp?
No, I didn't. But eventually the movie started and then, you know, the people who actually had those seats walked in later, like as the movie started and the security had to come in and like shine their flashlight and then like I could oversee them talking and they had to get up. But overall, if you're going to grab those seats, get there early because
for sure
you're a dick for one. And
you just admitted that you're a dick. Which I'm not going to argue with. But
better than an asshole.
Oh, we didn't even talk about Incredibles.
Yeah, we were talking about Incredibles.
Basically, Elastigirl has to go be a superhero again, and Mr. Incredible has to like babysit Jack-Jack, who is a monster demonic baby that has all these superpowers and is going to probably destroy the world.
This is taking place immediately after the last movie. It's correct. Not like a few years in the future or something. Okay.
Is it going to slide in just like freaking Jeepers Creepers 3 right in between there?
Hey, no diddling in this episode.
Yeah. You brought it up.
You brought up Jeepers Creepers.
Fine. Pass.
Too many diddling references.
Let's go.
All right. Ryan Murphy, creator of American Horror Story and Glee, has signed a 5-year, $300 million deal with Netflix. Maybe they're going to let American Horror Story die now because it hasn't been good in years. I like a lot of his work.
My problem with American Horror Story is that the first 4 or 5 episodes will grip you into the universe and be like, oh, this is actually pretty cool. And then they'll just like trail off the last like 10 episodes. And you're like, I don't care anymore. After the second season, I was like, meh.
Also, like, here's Lady Gaga in an orgy for some reason.
What was the season orgy with the circus?
I think it was called American Horror Story Circus.
Freak Show.
Freak Show.
Freak Show, Freak Show, nice. Right? Sure. Yeah, was that third season or fourth?
That was that clown was really cool. I thought that murder clown was actually pretty sweet. And then they just like, it was just tail off at the end. I'm like, this was good enough. We'll just,
That's a bummer.
Always.
Yeah. It's like Altered Carbon where it's really good in the beginning. And then they know that you're hooked.
Fizzle.
So they can just
fizzle the rest of this.
I remember watching the first season. And if I have this correct, it was all about this guy who was in this haunted house, but he thought this lady was a lot younger than she was. He was like imagining her as like
they were seeing ghosts. It was the haunted house and the ghost.
Wasn't
and
he
had
having
that
sexual relations with her, with the ghost? And the ghost was ghost?
Like,
in
that
old
imp suit. The ghost was like raping them in the imp suit or whatever. Yeah.
That's really weird.
Oh, yeah.
Reminds me of that scene in Ghostbusters when the ghost gives Dan Aykroyd a blowjob.
What?
You don't remember that?
No.
I don't remember that either.
He's like sleeping in the firehouse. There's no, like, you can't see a ghost.
The implication.
His belt undoes itself and his pants slide down and then you see his eyes go crossed. You don't remember that?
No.
That's crazy.
That's hilarious.
Fun fact, I've never seen Ghostbusters.
What?
Whoa.
Get out.
I've never seen Ghostbusters.
Somebody, the police are here.
My sisters bought me the box DVD set of 1 and 2 and something else and I never watched it.
Why?
For Christmas. Yeah.
Those movies are amazing.
I don't know. I opened it like 5 years ago on Christmas and I was like, oh great, I'm never watching this.
I'm so blown away by this.
I don't know, I just never got into it.
And you want to be a movie guy.
Yeah.
All right, I'll watch Ghostbusters this week sometime.
It was formative. I watched that in my formative years. So that's, if you want to know what ruined me, that's what it was.
I'm too busy watching
blaming it on Ghostbusters blowjobs.
Too busy watching Paddington the Bear.
Nice. No, Paddington, god,
Paddington Bear man.
Paddington Bear Kid.
Speaking of Paddington Bear.
Human.
The Hollywood Reporter claims that Paul King, the director of Paddington 2, is in final talks to direct another Willy Wonka film.
That could be awesome.
Paddington 2 has still one of the highest ratings ever on.
It's 100% currently still.
We'll get to your thoughts in a second, but.
My synopsis.
Is anybody really looking for another Willy Wonka movie?
No.
Who do we got playing the crazy Charlie?
Probably Johnny Depp again. Does it matter?
I never liked those movies to begin with.
Make something original.
That's the flute. I just did it. So
thanks. I guess this is a segue. Do you want to talk Paddington 2 now?
I guess.
Sorry, Paddington 1 and 2. Paddington, so those of you who were not listening 2 weeks ago, we made a bet on the Super Bowl. I took the Eagles. Mark took the Patriots, obviously. There was a little bit of leverage there that said if the Eagles lost, I only had to watch Paddington 2. But since the Pats were favored, Mark had to watch both of them, and he is now going to give us his very brief, hopefully, overview of these movies.
I think in order to make this segment not drag, we reserve the right to just be have like a skip button. Skip.
I'll just speed it up.
Yeah, that works. Well, then everybody just read that super fast. We should skip, and he has to stop whatever he's saying and go to the next point. But we can only do that like once or twice or a bunch. I don't know.
Yeah, a whole bunch. Also, start thinking of something else. We need to make another bet. This needs to be a recurring thing, and the loser has to watch something terrible. Like, for instance, did you see the trailer for that Hurricane Heist movie? Because that looks atrocious.
I think Geostorm is on Netflix.
I would not be surprised by that.
That could be a good one to do.
Or the new 50 Shades of Grey movie.
We need to get a comprehensive list of movies that we should torture each other to watch.
Okay.
Trolls 2 needs to come. We need to get a Trolls 2.
That might be too enjoyable.
You guys should watch Trolls 2. Just so you understand, when I talk about Trolls 2,
no,
what I'm talking about.
All right, back to Paddington.
All right.
Break it down.
Skip.
Come on, write that shit out.
Paddington the Bear. Paddington starts out in the Peruvian forest in Peru.
Makes sense.
Does that make sense? Okay. So Paddington the Bear is a small baby pet bear. I said pear.
Stop. Bear. You need to say this more of a British accent.
Yeah, start over.
Paddington the Bear.
Okay. Paddington the Bear.
Welcome to
what
Paddington.
What was my accent before? Not good.
You were half-assing just a British accent.
Inquisit. Okay.
You are right there, though. You are on the cusp of greatness and glory.
Paddington the Bear.
Oh, a little cold. Don't dial a bit. I'm trying
to figure it out. I'm trying to get in character.
Get your juncture. You're good. That didn't make sense. Whatever. Say brilliant a lot, also.
Paddington the Bear is a bear from the Peruvian rainforest. He lives with his Aunt Lucy and his uncle...
Skip.
Pastuzo. That's a hard name. I've never understood what the fuck his uncle's name was.
Are they also bears, or is this one of those weird...
So, yes. Okay. He lives with his bear family in the Peruvian forest, with his uncle, Pastuzo, and his Aunt Lucy.
Pastuzo.
The story starts out by giving him some background as to why these bears can communicate and are basically human-like.
Intelligent.
It's because an old English settler was exploring through the Peruvian forest long time ago, whatever. And he ended up teaching these bears how to make marmalade, which is what they fucking eat on any sandwich.
Marmalade?
They only make marmalade sandwiches. I have no idea why.
I have never heard of
them. They love
marmalade,
these bears, and they make them themselves. So this English explorer teaches them to make marmalade, teaches them to talk, all that bullshit.
Marmalade.
You get some background to that, and then it jumps to Paddington the Bear living with his family currently in the Peruvian forest.
Boy, that accent tailed off real quick.
The story starts out with Aunt Lucy and Uncle Pastuzo.
Uncle P. We'll call him Uncle P.
This is fucking painful, man. Just get to it.
Let's just go out. What'd you think of it? And then
no. Let me finish. Okay, so we're still in the forest. Uncle Pastuzo gives Paddington the Bear that red hat that he's famous for. You know that hat I'm talking about?
Dope hat.
Dope hat. But anyways, an earthquake happens in the forest. Uncle Pastuzo dies.
No!
When Uncle Pastuzo dies, Aunt Lucy realizes that this isn't the safest place for Paddington, and because of her becoming of old age, he shouldn't be living with her anymore. He sends Paddington the Bear to London, where he is to live.
London?
She ships him out on this... I think she puts him on a cruise ship and he just chills in one of those little reserve boats. But he's basically survives by making marmalade in this reserve boat on his way to London.
Where does he get the ingredients for marmalade?
I have
on
no
a boat.
I think she gives him a bunch of marmalade to leave with. But he just eats marmalade the whole time on this little rescue boat.
I need marmalade. I've never had marmalade.
Of course, Paddington gets to London. His first place he goes is to the train station. And it happens to be Paddington train station. That's a train stop, I guess.
What? Okay. I don't care enough to ask.
We then meet the Brown family who is getting off the train. They see Paddington the Bear.
Excuse me, African American.
The Brown Bear family.
The Brown family is the last name. Their last name is Browns. So they see Paddington the Bear asking for a place to live. He's holding up a little sign saying he has nowhere to go. Whatever.
Yeah, man, you're a bear. Go in the forest.
The Brown family consists of Sally Hawkins, who plays Skip. The Shape of Water, Eliza.
Okay, good.
Man, she's real horny for animals, isn't she?
Oh my God. We'll get to that. And then we have Hugh Bonneville, who's Mr. Brown. I don't know. And then two kids. The whole scenario kind of reminds me, this whole movie reminded me of Stuart Little to some sense, but it wasn't a bad movie. He goes and lives with this family. The fucking bear can't do anything right. He's always fucking shit up. It's one of those things where
he's a fucking bear.
All he has to do is brush his teeth, but he accidentally hits the knob off the faucet and the faucet like
explodes.
Is exploding and shooting out water. And before you know it, he's filling the whole bathroom up with water. It's funny because one scene was the same exact scene in Shape of Water where there's a scene where he fills the bathroom up and the dad goes up to the bathroom, puts his ear on the door. He's like, Paddington, you in there? And then all of a sudden opens the door and all the water comes out just like Shape of Water. Nicole Kidman is the antagonist in this.
Really?
Yes.
I did not know that.
She plays Millicent, who is a, what's the word I'm looking for?
Bear hater.
You collect fur, taxidermist. She's a taxidermist, and she wants Paddington the Bear so she can stuff him, basically.
That's dark.
There's no really meaning behind it. She doesn't have any ties to him. She just wants to stuff
bear.
Paddington the Bear.
Yeah, why do you want that specific bear? Also, Paddington is a bear. Why doesn't he just eat her?
He doesn't. He's a very polite bear.
Just cover her in marmalade or whatever. Talk,
he calls everyone sir, Mrs., Mr.
Well, he's British.
He's very polite.
Well, that was Paddington the Bear.
All right. Can you give me the very, very quick synopsis of Paddington 2 and why it's so great?
I didn't finish Paddington 2.
You son of a...
What?
Listen, it's
free
getting
giveaway,
good.
Free giveaway by Mark this week. You didn't finish.
It's getting good. So Paddington the Bear 2 starts, I guess, pretty soon after the last one ends. He wants the whole premise of the whole movie is he wants to get this pop-up book, which is in an old antique shop for his Aunt Lucy for her 100th birthday.
Damn.
That's an old-ass bear.
Old-ass.
The one that's still living in the Peruvian forest and told him to go out on his own and live by himself. I have no idea why she would do that to her own nephew. But anyways, so he wants to get her this pop-up book. Hugh Grant is in this movie.
Of course.
And he is the antagonist now. And the whole thing behind that is... He was an actor, but now he's doing shitty commercials and everyone makes fun of him in the town, which is pretty hilarious. He wants this pop-up book because Paddington doesn't know, but he knows that this book was one of the old English explorers' books, and it actually is a map to find a shit ton of
classic scenario.
Treasure. Yeah. So Paddington just wants the book because he likes the book and wants to give it to his aunt. And then Hugh Grant wants this book because it's gonna get him rich.
And I think Hugh Grant has a better.
And the whole story I left off right now. Paddington the Bear was gonna go buy the book. He saved up all this money. By the way, the book was $1,000, and he was cutting hair and, of course, fucking everyone's hair up. It was just reckless stuff. He almost killed a guy. But
he's a bear cutting hair. Come on,
he's a bear cutting hair. So he goes to buy this book, and of course, Hugh Grant is breaking into the shop, and Paddington goes to try to make the arrest or stop him. He ends up getting framed for it. They don't believe him. They think Paddington stole the book.
I would believe a bear either.
Yeah.
Dude, he's a bear.
Paddington's trying to explain that it wasn't him, and he's trying to uncover the mystery of who stole the book, but we know it's Hugh Grant the whole time.
Hugh Grant can't scrounge up $1,000 and buy
Hugh
a book.
Hugh Grant's a piece of shit.
That's like two commercial jobs.
Overall, I'm sorry about that review. It went on probably a little too long, but these movies are pretty entertaining, especially if you have like little nephews. I would recommend watching them. They reminded me, like I said, of Stuart Little movies.
Now that everyone is
I'm not
fully
that
asleep.
Mad about doing it. I would personally rather watch Paddington 1 and 2 than probably watch Jeepers Creepers 3.
Yeah, that sucked. Yeah.
Yeah. So we gotta think of a bet. We'll post it later on and figure something out. But there are enough shitty movies out there or TV shows that we can keep doing this.
Maybe we do. Maybe we ask the audience what shitty movie should the last to the person have to watch based off of our Twitter poll.
Maybe. All right. Mark, did you watch the English version of the Batman Ninja trailer?
I did not yet.
It has Sumo Bane in it.
I heard about that, and I'm going to watch it immediately after we're done recording.
Yeah, it's dope. Very weird looking.
It's weird looking?
Yes.
It's cool looking?
I mean, it's you guys saw the Japanese version of it.
Sumo Bane.
It's just weird.
Hey, do we have a Decker review here for comics?
I did not get a chance to read any, but if you need a recommendation, The Wicked and the Divine.
You're still reading that?
I'm behind a couple issues, but yes, I am still reading that.
Suck it, Decker. I guess. That's what Ryan said to you.
It's Jamie McKelvey, and I forget who's doing the art, but basically every, I believe, 88 years, 12 people on Earth are given these extreme powers, and they're basically gods, and it lasts for like 2 years, and it's the story of like modern day, and they're basically rock stars and shit, but somebody is killing them.
I read the first trade. I thought it was awesome.
Damn, that's a very cool concept of a story.
A really good, really good concept.
What's it called again?
The Wicked and the Divine.
Cool.
There's your recommendation. Boom. The Cloverfield Paradox. Did either of you watch this yet?
No.
Yes, I did.
What'd you think?
I liked it a lot.
I thought it was pretty good.
Nothing to say.
People got really mad about the ending.
Why?
They did kind of, and it's hard to talk about without spoiling it, but they did kind of shoehorn tie it in to the other Cloverfield universe.
I haven't seen those either, so I don't care.
I'm not going to spoil it, but reportedly it got over 5 million views in its first week, pretty good. I mean, it's got the name recognition, right?
And they had the Super Bowl commercial.
Wow, they gave it a 17%?
That's ridiculous. It was way better than that.
I think for the humor in the movie, you should have given it a much higher rating. I thought it was pretty funny throughout the movie.
Really?
Yeah. I thought
it's a lot
Chris
of dry
O'Dowd.
Humor. Yeah, Chris O'Dowd is really
I thought
funny.
He was great in that movie. Like, I mean, the whole hand
that was
sequence
hilarious.
Going on, that was hilarious.
I mean, it didn't make a ton of sense. But
it didn't, but it doesn't really matter.
I don't care. They're in space. You know,
it didn't make a ton of sense to us, but at the same time, didn't make any sense to them. So it was, in some sense, okay.
It makes zero sense to me right now, this whole conversation.
The sense of the sense was...
Well, it was one of those things where in the beginning, they have this scientist that's warning them that if you do this, there's an extreme possibility that you'll open up a gateway to monsters. Like, how do you know this, dude?
Like, I just know shit.
Who are you?
Why do you know this? And if you know this, why aren't you working for NASA?
He's that time traveler.
It might be.
Getting into that best man alive right here. Or worst man. I don't even know.
We'll get there in a second. I do have a couple more things I wanted to mention. From the director of Pixels and discoverer of America, Chris Columbus, he is going to be directing the film adaptation of Five Nights at Freddy's. So we talked about this once it got greenlit. You are familiar as a gamer, correct? Five Nights at Freddy's?
Not at this point.
It's basically a horror game. Imagine you're stuck in Chuck E. Cheese overnight and the animatronic things are trying to kill you.
Interesting.
Except it's a teddy bear.
Okay.
It's got a very big cult following, but okay. I really thought you would have something to say about this.
Yeah, nope. Not
moving on.
Unfortunately.
The biggest and most important best news of the week is
Let me interject real quick. That I don't know why that made me think of this, but Zombies Ate My Neighbors. Anybody play that game?
Oh, yeah, for
sure. That game needs to get remade.
Super Nintendo.
Hell yeah. That game. Why isn't that game remade? That was a brilliant game. So
they probably put some super dark twist on it or make it terrible. But I mean, it would be great.
Yeah, no, I'd be into it. That's one game that hasn't been remade that should be remade. I don't know why that's just thought of it. I just thought of that movie, and that's just the ADD in me, but boom.
Perfect.
Zombies Ate My Neighbors, boom.
Anyways, the biggest, most important news of the week is that Kung Fury is getting a sequel, and I was devastated to find out, similar to Ghostbusters, that neither of you have ever seen this.
Nope, I have never
it's
seen it.
It's like 35 minutes long, and it's just the most ridiculous, over-the-top 80s parody satire. This guy is like a super cop in L.A., and Hitler comes back, and it's just amazing.
When did this come out?
And it's 35 minutes?
Yeah, it's really short, like maybe 40 minutes max, but this came out like 3 or 4 years ago. It's awesome.
It's just a show?
Yeah, that's it.
40 minutes.
I want to say it's the guys that from Lonely Island Lonely Island.
Yeah, okay. Andy Samberg.
Could be wrong about that. It's not Andy Samberg. It's the other two. Okay. Jorma Taccone, I think is his name. But they're getting a sequel to this, and Michael Fassbender is going to star. And David Hasselhoff and Arnold Schwarzenegger are also connected to this.
Yes.
And I could not be more excited for this.
Give me an Arnold impression.
Yo. They are my cookies.
Keep going.
Put the cookie down. Put the cookie down.
Terrible. That is the news that I have for this week. Should we get into the Best Man Alive? Mark, you kind of had something there.
I was going to go with something else. I can do two Best Men Alive. One's a woman.
I believe in you.
So my first one is this woman who actually joined her handbag in the x-ray machine to prevent her bag from being stolen. So she hopped in the x-ray machine at the security line at the airport and basically went through the conveyor belt x-ray machine with her handbag because she thought it was going to get stolen.
That's so hilarious.
That's some dedication right there. I can't believe
they let her in the machine. They're like, all right, this crazy lady won't like put her purse in here. Can we just like let her through the machine? Yeah. All right.
Yeah, it's a little sketchy, but obviously she didn't have anything in her bag that...
No, but now she has cancer.
Yeah, she got radiation poison.
There's a good chance of that. They think she did that because she might have been carrying a lot of cash for the Chinese New Year. They think she was traveling to go see her family or something. But anyways, that's some dedication, hopping in the x-ray machine at the airport. Holy shit. And there's pictures online too. So if you're interested in seeing pictures of her in this x-ray machine, you can see them online.
That is very weird.
So amazing. She gets my best woman alive.
Can't teach heart.
My next one is, I don't know the guy's name. I think most people will know who I'm talking about.
Nostradamus.
So yeah, didn't they call him Noah?
Noah. I think that is his name. Yes, Ryan, you were right. We'll go with Noah. This guy, Noah, supposedly is from the future. I think he says he's from the year 2030 and he traveled back in time, but nobody knew from the future that he was doing this. So there's a possibility he could be killed for this. But anyways, he goes on a tangent saying that he is revealing all the shit that's going to happen in the future. One being Trump's going to get elected for a second term and all this other stuff. He also predicts there's another future leader claiming the U.S. president of 2030 will be a random person named Ramiki. He also claims that humans will reach Mars in 2028, the same year time travel will be discovered, and that Google Glass style robots will take over the world. So that's going
to
happen.
So this guy's actually trying to save the world.
I guess.
He's warning us.
Fortune favors the bold, and he decided to travel back in time to warn us all without being able to tell us who he is.
All right, a few things here.
And why?
If you wake up and you're Ilana Ramiki, and you hear this story, are you like, what the fuck? Am I supposed to run for president now?
Just woken up from
like the actual Ilana Ramiki.
So you got to be 35 to be the president, right? And he's saying that in 12 years. So this is not just like a kid. This is someone who is probably working... Maybe in college.
Very specific name too.
Yeah. Yeah, that's not like John Smith.
Yeah, that's a little too... That's like a Nostradamus just, oh, I'm going to throw a bunch of shit at a wall and then things will come true.
Also...
Ilana Ramiki, did you do specific year too? 2030?
2030.
And so, then that's the year when... Was it 2028?
2028, we go to Mars.
Oh, and then when do Google...
Glass bots are 2028. We also discover time travel in 2028 and we go to Mars in 2028.
Okay, well,
that's what he's that's what he's saying is going to happen.
I had a weird thought the other day when I was playing. I hooked up my Nintendo Switch into my Xbox One and for a brief moment I thought of, what if I've created a super machine and just they're going to take over the world? Alexa just like announced, like does some sort of voice command to these Xbox connected to the Switch and just creates the Google Glass.
Brit, do you realize what you have done?
Yeah, actually.
You have freed me from my electronic prison.
Wahoo!
Now just prepare to die.
And bend over.
You just like tried to divide by zero and now there's a black hole in your living room.
Yeah. Too many.
Anyways, back to Noah though.
Sorry.
If you're coming back from the future, you said he passed a
lie
detector.
Yeah, that was a whole point I was going to tell people. He's back in the news. This happened a month ago. He's claiming he's a 50-year-old guy that took an age-reversing drug to make him 25 again. And the only reason he's doing this is just to prove that time travel exists.
So he's just Benjamin Buttoning himself.
I guess. But I brought this up because he's back in the news. He's now taking a lie detector and he's passing the lie detector test, which is pretty hilarious.
So
what are the questions that
you
have?
So either two things. He's telling the truth. Or he's completely insane and truly believes he's a time-traveling Benjamin Button.
If he believes himself, you can pass a lie detector test.
It's not a lie.
He could just be a full crazy person.
It's not a lie. If you believe it.
But if you come back from the future.
It's not a lie if you believe it.
Yeah.
Better than a lie detector test is if he's not rich, he's lying.
No.
Because if you come back from the future with information from the future, you immediately use that to get rich.
No, no, no. If you're coming back from the future where world is taken over by Google Chrome bots or whatever, being rich isn't your first priority. It's telling the world, Google is going to take over the freaking world. What are we doing, people?
You got 10 years, man. And also, you can get rich and get into power and then do something about it.
Priorities, Ryan. Save the world.
He's kind of doing something from the rich aspect. I haven't read the article, but I saw something saying that somebody brought up Bitcoin and he was talking about Bitcoin and the value of it.
I knew this was coming up somehow. I knew this was coming up.
I should probably read into that article because depending on what he says, I either put my mortgage into Bitcoin based on Noah's predictions or his truth, I'll say, this not a so prediction. Ridiculous.
Get this man some crazy pills.
I don't know. We'll see.
Yeah. So
if Trump was elected a second term, is the first thing you're going to think of is this Noah guy?
No. First, I'll think, what the fuck are we doing? But then I'll think Noah was right. Yeah. I don't know. Brick, you got a best man alive for me?
I do. And I'm going to go with, yeah, I got nobody. All right. Sick.
Way to be positive. Yeah. Everybody is great. That's the positivity.
My best man in the world is everybody. And best woman in the world is everybody. Best human in the world, everybody. I can exclude some people. I won't get into the details, but.
Well, on the theme of positivity, my sister is having another baby. So nice. That baby is going to be my.
Hey, congrats.
Best person alive. Thank
you. Well, way to stay positive.
Congrats on the new nephew or niece. Do you know yet?
I don't know yet. She's not due until August.
Just announced her pregnancy.
Okay. I'm the best human to be alive, right?
Life begins at conception.
All right. Yeah. Now we're going down a deep path here. Yeah. And we're talking abortion. Here we go. All right.
Yeah, pass. So way to turn that dark.
Yeah, well, all right.
You son of a...
Way to flip it.
I mean, you good person.
Yeah. Everyone in the world who is alive is my best person.
Oh, you don't like dead people? Yeah. You're a real son of a bitch.
Yeah.
Well, did your sister find out for your nephew, right? Is it a niece or nephew?
I have a niece.
A niece.
She will be 2 in June.
Did she find out the gender or... Can we yes. say gender anymore? The thing of the baby?
The spectrum of the baby? What is the spectrum of the
what
baby?
What does the baby identify as? Yes.
Speaking of that, I was in H&M the other day because there was an H&M by the movie theater and I was there like an hour early. So I just walked in there. There was a sweater that said end gender.
Did you leave immediately?
I did.
With it in hand and bought it?
In three colors.
It said gender and then it had the end in the gender highlighted. And I was just like, God damn it. This is also coming from H&M, who, what did they do? They had like, a tag on the shirt that said monkey or something.
It was like the smartest monkey in the jungle or something like that. And it was a little black kid and everybody called. I think that was the Gap. It might've been, I don't know. Doesn't matter.
I think it was H&M.
Well, they've done plenty of stupid shit.
But anyway, sure
people in sweatshops make their clothes. So maybe don't make a political statement.
True. Back to what I was saying. Did she find out the gender of?
Of the first one?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So I will know.
Are they going to, they're going to do it again?
Yes.
Okay.
I never understood not wanting to know. Like, don't you have shit to plan out? You going to paint the room pink?
You could paint it a neutral color.
I just,
a gender neutral color.
I just think that like you start buying clothes and shit and I don't know.
I think what I think personally is I think it makes more sense to do it for your first kid. But once it's like the second, third kid, you should probably find out.
Yeah, I would think.
Because you're going to want to know if let's say you have a daughter, you're going to want to know if you need to buy boys' clothes or if you could just use your daughter's hand-me-downs,
and
you know, for your
also,
other daughter.
You get to do one of those super cool and original gender reveal parties.
Yeah. Yeah, so, funny story. My dad initially didn't want to find out the gender and then said that he wanted to know. So, my mom was at the doctor by herself and then had the doctor tell her what the gender was. And then she called my dad back and she's like, okay, I know. He's like, actually, I don't want to know. So my mom's like, no, I'm fucking telling you.
You ruined it for your mom.
Yeah.
Jeez. All right.
That's hilarious. You botched it. Actually, being indecisive.
Yeah. You can't piss off a pregnant lady either.
Yeah. Big mistake.
Especially
big
one that's that mistake. Pregnant. That's a terrible idea. Yeah. So I showed up at my sister's house on Friday and Fallon, my niece, who is a year and a half old, was wearing a shirt that said Big Sister. So that's how I found out.
Cool. That's
great. So everybody in the world is the best person alive this week.
With some exceptions.
It's like when everybody was Time's Person of the Year.
Oh, there's a video game store named Games Bond. But there's not a video game clip page, so you're good.
I'm going to use the signature games, G4MES. Keep it consistent.
Mark, are you okay? I think you just concussed yourself.
It's these fucking stool chairs, whatever don't they are.
It's a stool. Don't blame the stool for you hitting your head on it.
I will, because I'm not used to the back of the chair being this high.
All right, so let me explain what just happened. We took a little break, and I, during our little conversation, I was bringing up, I'm going to bring up a new, like, games account. And I was like, yo, what should be, like, a good James account that I can make turn into a games? And Mark just, like, stares blankly at me for, like, a good, like, 5 or 6 seconds, just goes, James Bond, and then proceeds to sit down, leans forward, and bashes his head on the seat right in front of him, actual concussed.
That sounded painful.
It was a thick
I hit it
thud.
Pretty hard. It's all right. It was worth it because that's a good name.
So title. We got a new one coming out with LeBron games doing sports clips only.
All 2K.
2K, Madden, or whatever. NHL. Yeah.
But who's good enough at sports games to have some pretty cool clips? Like, you're good enough at shooters and you do some dumb shit where it's fun watching your PUBG or Battlefield clips. True. But, and you have other friends that are really good at Battlefield, like Duhast and all those guys who in the gaming universe is really good at sports games where it's, and sports games in general, unless there's like some weird lag shit going on in a game or something funny happens.
They
I don't know how
Greg over. Jennings putting the team on his back.
Yeah.
A broken leg, Greg
something
Jennings.
Something like that. Yeah. It has to be something unique. I don't know. I feel agree. Like that's a once in a.
There's two. I'm sure there's 2K accounts. I'll look into it. We'll figure it out. There's always funny.
We'll think about it.
Games clips.
Are you guys ready to take a trip to Africa? Why?
Very much so.
The magical city of Wakanda.
That's in Wisconsin.
I literally wanted them to just say Wakanda, Illinois, or whatever.
Oh, is that Wisconsin or Illinois? Wakanda's Illinois, actually.
I don't think that that's a real place.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, it is.
Wakanda is.
Seriously?
Yeah.
Hmm.
W-A-U-C-O-N-D-A, Wakanda.
Thanks for spelling that for me. Can you use it in a sentence?
Because it is a different.
I have to just make sure I could continue spelling because I hit my head hard as shit on that chair.
Yeah, you have like a large Looney Tunes off the top of his head right now.
Birdie's tweeting around him. All right, let's talk Black Panther, shall we?
Okay.
So this movie was directed by Ryan Coogler, who did movies such as Fruitvale Station and Creed. Actually, Michael B. Jordan was in both of those. So that's kind of his connection to that.
He likes Michael. He's a good actor. He did a really good job in this.
We watched something briefly before. I didn't realize that he was from Compton, Ryan Coogler.
Didn't know that either.
I didn't know.
What?
He, well,
Man, are you okay?
Yeah, I'm like, where did I hear he was from? Oakland, and then Oakland.
Oakland. We were like, we actually did know that, but we did know he was from Oakland, though.
He's from Oakland.
Whatever. This movie is currently at 97% on Rotten Tomatoes, open at 100, but it's 74% from fans. There's a little bit of fuckery going on with this because there are Facebook groups of people that are supposed to just go to IMDb and Rotten Tomatoes
bash
and just
it.
Vote it down.
Yeah.
Because
what?
I don't know.
People are dumb.
Seriously, this is how you know life has gotten to be too easy, is that we can argue about stupid shit like this.
So audiences are giving it a what? A 70?
They're rating it down. It's a 74% from fans on Rotten Tomatoes.
So these are all like the Nazi tiki torture guys? Just it's like, all right,
we need to get back on Rotten Tomatoes and vote down on that.
You don't have anything better to do with your life than that?
Stupidest thing I've ever
heard. So fucking stupid. Doesn't really matter because this movie opened to about $220 million in the first
weekend. Right?
Yes.
It beat Outdoor.
This is going to probably break a lot of box office records.
Well, what was the next highest box office for a superhero movie?
I don't have the answer to that in front of me.
Okay. I thought it was Thor.
Sweet knowledge.
I thought Thor was the highest.
Or I feel
maybe
like
Homecoming?
Because every new movie release, there's so much more hype.
Yeah.
Because Avengers is going to crush all of these anyway.
Oh, yeah. Avengers is going to blow everything out of the water.
Yeah.
Break most movies. I want to buy tickets now. Can I buy tickets now?
As soon as they go on sale, you're going to have to. Because even this was almost sold out immediately. My theater had to open two more screenings.
Unless you bought the wheelchair seats like me.
Yeah, except I'm not a jerk.
Yeah.
I mean, you're great, Mark. You're so nice and stuff.
Even
you're
like
a fucking liar.
Theaters up north, I had to like go to. I couldn't do a Saturday morning show without having botched.
Crazy,
seeing.
Right?
Insane.
And I think a lot of that is now they're selling tickets so far ahead of time.
True.
And if you try to, like, I tried to buy mine 2 days ahead of time, which was dumb. I should have done it earlier, which I will do with Avengers. And I'll probably actually, we should go see that in IMAX.
Yeah. Fuck yeah, we should.
That would be worth it.
I have an IMAX ticket right here because I accidentally bought tickets to the wrong theater for Star Wars.
I forgot about that.
Which I haven't seen yet.
Idiot.
I'm never going to use it because when do you fucking go to IMAX unless it's like the big release where I don't have time to go during like the day where no one would go to an IMAX.
Sure.
But I can't like redeem it online and buy it. I have to go to the theater and then buy it, which is like, all right, everyone buys it in advance anyway.
Yeah.
So this is going to be in my wallet forever, I think. I'm never going to be able to use this.
Just go and try to return it.
All right.
Like, I didn't see this movie, sir. I would like to return it, please.
I returned the movie one time. Now I'm going to return this.
You're that guy.
Altogether, actually.
Back to Black Panther, maybe. Starring Chadwick Boseman. This actually had a really good cast. Like, a very deep, you know, like, you see somebody, you're like, what do I recognize? We were talking earlier about
Forrest Whitaker.
Letitia Wright.
That's right, yeah.
Who we saw recently in Black Mirror. Forrest Whitaker.
Black Museum.
I did not expect to see him. I had no idea he was in this movie. And then somebody comes up with a lazy eye, and I'm like, whoa, it's Forrest Whitaker.
Yeah. I loved that in 1992, the guy who played Forrest Whitaker's guy had the eye thing. They made him have the eye thing.
Yeah, yeah.
That was my biggest complaint about Westworld, is that the man in black doesn't have the fucking Jimmy McPoyle big mole on his face.
That's true.
Seriously, it doesn't make any sense.
You can get moles removed.
You'd have a scar.
No.
Shut up. You're wrong. All right, we got Michael B. Jordan, who plays the villain in this, Eric Killmonger. I thought he was excellent. He's probably the best part of this movie.
I agreed. He was a bamf.
Lupita Nyong'o, Oscar winner. Martin Freeman, one of the two white guys in this, plays Everett Ross, and apparently is going to be a bigger part of Avengers and going to be in Marvel movies going forward, so that's kind of interesting. We have Andy Serkis, who plays Ulysses Klaue. We saw him very briefly in Avengers Age of Ultron when he was trying to get more vibranium, I guess. I thought this was kind of a wasted character.
What character was it? I'm
Andy Serkis?
Yeah, who's that?
Ulysses Klaue?
Yeah. The white guy.
Oh, the white guy. The crazy guy who was singing.
Yeah, Australian type guy. I liked him.
I liked him too. I thought he was good. I thought he was a good character. He's just a psycho.
I thought he had more development than Michael B. Jordan had as a character.
Oh, definitely not.
You don't think so?
You don't know anything about his background. I mean, you know why he doesn't have a hand, because you saw it in Avengers, but.
Yeah.
Michael B. had a better background, obviously. But yeah. I liked him just being a crazy psycho, just guy on the street trying to obtain this iron or whatever it's called.
Titanium. Yeah, no, it's a fake thing.
I think I liked him because one of my favorite scenes of the movie in the casino,
that was the only action that I enjoyed. Actually,
really, the forefront of the action.
It was, the other stuff was like cool. The waterfall fights were like cool, but they weren't like
well, let's talk good and bad then, and then we'll do our ratings, and we'll spoil it a little bit later. But it sounds like you didn't really care for the action. There were a couple of good scenes. I thought it was kind of a slow start.
I agree.
Yeah, it was a slow start. And the one, I'll just go, the one action scene sequence that they had was awesome. There was
the car chase?
The car chase, but also like this, the action in the casino. The woman with the spear had some badass moves. What was her name? She was married to...
That's when the score picked up,
Okoye.
Too.
She's played by Danai Gurira.
And she's married to Get Out Guy.
She's Daniel Michonne Kula, from Walking Dead.
Who is also in this, yeah. But you wouldn't recognize her because she doesn't have hair.
She had some dope ass moves. And
yeah, for sure.
She was killing it. And then when he turns the car with his claws, my friend and I looked at each other at the same time. We're just like, sick. At the same time, it was actually amazing. But then they just like didn't follow up with anything that I really thought was like as cool or mind-blowing. With the suit was like cool.
Yeah, and, well, you see Marvel movie and you think like big action set pieces, and there were only one or two of those.
You think Marvel movie, you think big action set pieces, but you also think at least some humor. And I don't think the humor for me didn't land as much as normal for Marvel movies.
You don't like played out old jokes?
Exactly. Damn.
What are those?
Yeah.
All right, dude.
But there was like missed opportunity. Like when they made the suit, and he tried it on for the first time or whatever, he could like put it on backwards or something stupid, just like to add in some goofiness.
Comedy isn't really Ryan Coogler's thing, but you had a great cast, obviously. You could have thrown a few more jokes in there. Klaue is basically the funniest character, and that's just because he's an insane person.
Yeah, and do you think because the last Marvel movie they made was Thor and they went super over the top with the humor that maybe this like wasn't...
So that was the thing for me, is I watched Thor again the night before I went to go see Black Panther, so... When you juxtapose those, it's so far on different ends of the spectrum. Look, this is a good movie. It's not a great movie. I don't really know what else to say about it. I liked Thor better.
So did I.
I think the funniest, who I thought was the funniest, was the leader of the tribe up in the mountains of the gorilla tribe.
Yeah.
I thought he was one of the funniest when he does the joke saying that he was going to eat their children. But then he's like, I'm just kidding. I'm vegetarian.
Yeah,
he's pretty funny.
There is some humor in there that definitely landed, but they missed opportunities.
I thought that the entire set design was great. I had questions about it because when they go into Wakanda, and this is supposedly the richest nation in the world, why aren't the streets paved? Like, why do you still... I get that they're trying to reflect Afrofuturism and stuff,
culture still, yeah.
That's not what it would look like. I guess.
Speaking of atrofuturism, though, that guy with the lip ring wearing the green tuxedo looked so fresh, but that was the worst lip ring ever. That was just sucked ass.
Seriously, that has to be terrible.
Was that CGI'd or was that just a guy?
No, they probably got somebody from an African tribe and were like, hey, man, you want to come act in this movie?
Amazing.
Some of that stuff, though, just made me feel weird.
How so?
Like the rituals and stuff. I don't know. It was just, I can't really put my finger on it. Just, it was weird to watch.
Where they're all like jumping up, like bobbing up and down.
Yeah. Well, they don't really, I guess what I would have wanted is more of an explanation as to why they do those things.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yep.
It is kind of a savage thing to do. Let me murder you to be my king. Like,
yeah, it's kind of a badass thing to do.
It is super sick. Yeah.
Also, if you become king, don't you immediately just change that law?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, we're going to ruin that again.
Yeah, please. I think we're good on the trial by combat.
That's hilarious.
Michael B. Jordan loved when he was the king. I'm the king now.
So you pick one challenger to challenge the king. Who do you put?
Got to fight Chadwick Boseman.
You got to fight Chadwick Boseman.
John Bones Jones, man. He'll fuck anybody up.
You can't use steroids because if they strip away the black...
He doesn't need steroids, he just needs cocaine.
Okay, so John Jones on cocaine.
Yes. Okay. Absolutely.
Who do you have?
I would assume this would have to be someone of African-American descent.
You can assume I will.
I'll say Rampage Jackson.
John Jones beat the shit out of Rampage Jackson.
No. Not in a water fight. Not in high water.
Weapons. They get weapons and shit.
That's true. But Rampage Jackson would just like punch the fuck out of somebody. He's fucking huge.
If you got slammed by him in that rocky knee-high water.
Oh, you're dead.
You're dead.
Yeah.
Or he would just slam you off the
cliff. I'm just saying John Jones would beat him up.
I don't know. Get that legging.
He wouldn't have the legging.
John Jones on cocaine.
Yeah, but he wouldn't have the like the leg. The water would be tough to like do his long kicks and shit.
Whatever. Who's your pick?
Ray Lewis. Come on now. You got to do the pageantry. Imagine him walking out being like, I'm going to challenge you. Also, I've murdered someone before. Also, allegedly. Also, Ray Lewis. Imagine if he walked up and did his little shimmy shake out of there. That would have been so badass, dude. I would have rooted for Ray Lewis to kill him.
And then he leads everyone in prayer.
Exactly.
Mark, do you approve of the level of jackedness in this film?
I'm not going to lie. Michael B. Jordan was more jacked than Creed. He was more ripped.
You're probably right.
A lot more
ripped. He had like a million nipples or whatever. That like
nipples.
Yeah, right?
They're scars that represent the number of people that he's killed.
Yeah. He's got some
AKA
nips,
Killmonger.
Dude. Nip slips. Galore is what they should call him.
Okoye was fucking jacked. A lot of the women in this movie were jacked.
Yeah, Shredotrons.
Yeah, I mean, Chadwick Boseman was pretty cut up. Thought it was pretty good jackedness.
Give me a jackness
The
scale.
Guy I just mentioned, what's his name? I keep forgetting.
Michael B. Jordan?
No, the one up in the mountains in the gorilla tribe.
M'Baku. He was not shredded.
He was not in shape. Yeah, he's a big guy, but he was not in
shape. Give me a jackness scale. One being Ryan Smith, ten being Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Michael B. Jordan, 7. M'Baku, that's
negative
hard
three.
Because
Ryan Smith.
Yeah, he's just a big guy.
Yeah, get out of here with your negativity.
Sorry.
Yeah, I don't know. You can't put me on the spot like that.
That's all we needed. I just wanted to burn Ryan Smith real quick. That was it.
What about the level of violence? Did this satiate your bloodlust?
Why is it so directed at me?
Because you're always like, oh, they should have shown more blood. they did murder a lot of people in this movie.
They did. It was PG-13 though, so there was no real bloodlust, I would say. Michael B. Jordan was pretty ruthless as a character. He really didn't give any shits about who he killed and what kind of effect it had on the
And I kind of believed his motivation. Obviously, his plan was crazy, but you get why he's doing what he's doing, which has been a knock against Marvel films in the past. He is still, in the end, a villain who has the same exact skill set as the hero, which I don't really care for. You know,
it's as redundant as War Machine.
And he may or may not be actually have a better skill set.
Probably.
Whose suit would you want more? Spider-Man, Iron Man, or Black Panther?
Black Panther seems better.
Yes.
Black Panther has, I guess if get the suit, you'll get the flower too, I suppose. I'll add that in.
Black Panther can't fly though.
I'm going Spider-Man suit, dude. You haven't seen all the capabilities. He was poning on elementary mode or whatever the hell they called it.
Like maybe Tony Stark's Spider-Man suit.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
No, Black Panther, I think you gotta go Iron Man suit though. It can fly. It's the only suit that can fly.
What has a stronger structure? Would you say the Iron Man suit or with the Black Panther vibranium suit?
It's definitely the.
I think it's vibranium.
The vibranium suit,
yeah,
for sure.
It like absorbs and whatever
absorbs and dishes out.
But
bullets can't penetrate it.
If you're in the Iron Man suit, same thing with the Iron Man suit. If you're in the Iron Man suit, you can just fly away.
The
and
Iron Man
the Black
suit.
Panther suit doesn't shoot anything.
It has dope claws.
They can turn cars and stuff.
Yeah.
All right. Sick. Let's rate this so we can spoil it. I'm going to give this a 7. It, like I said, it was good. Wasn't great. Yeah, it's a Marvel movie. It's very much worth seeing, and it's worth seeing in a theater. The score is score. The soundtrack is awesome.
Amazing. But, there was so much snare. So much snare. I loved it. It was actually like bamf and sweet.
I can't remember if I said this earlier while we were recording, but if you're Kendrick Lamar, aren't you demanding that Ryan Coogler makes you like a badass warrior in this movie?
Make him a tribe leader, dude. I would have been a tribe leader of
for
that.
For sure. Like, listen, I'll do the soundtrack for you, but you got to put me in this movie.
Absolutely.
And I want points on the back end.
I'm in on that. That he should. Yeah, it was a botched move by Lamar for a fact.
All right, Brick, rate it.
There was one point in the movie where I looked at the phone and was like, is this going to be over soon? Like, only one time.
Okay.
7. I want to give it a 7. Because it was cool, and I wanted more humor and more action.
Mark.
Cool story, though.
Very cool story.
And cool, like, technology.
I will give it a 7.5. I really enjoyed just getting to learn more about this universe, which I'm not as familiar with from
what
a Marvel
standpoint.
Kind
of the city was sweet.
Yeah. I thought the visuals were awesome as well, which I wasn't surprised by. I like them better than Thor, I would actually say.
You like this better than Thor?
Visuals?
Yeah, the visuals
visually?
In it.
Oh, just the visuals, not the movie.
Visually, yes.
Okay. Obviously, every movie that comes out is going to be better than the last one, right?
Mm-hmm. Wasn't surprised by that. I don't think anyone in the audience was surprised by that. Marvel always does a great job. Killmonger as a villain, he was fine. At some points, like I said, I kind of preferred Circus as the villain, especially in the beginning, because he captured some of my favorite scenes in the movie, which were the casino scene and then the chase scene. I think there's still a lot to be uncovered and a lot of questions I have that aren't answered. So that being said, I'm looking forward to Infinity War moving forward. But at the same time, some parts of me thought this movie in some aspects could have been better. That's why it gets a 7.5.
Yeah, it suffers again from having so much hype.
Yes.
Like the early screening reviews were like, this is the best movie ever. It's going to change the way you see. It's not. It's really good. And I'm glad that a black superhero has representation now and all that. And
yeah.
For a lot of people, it probably was the best movie they've seen because they can relate to it.
Yes.
But for me, as just a white dude, it was a good movie.
It
was good.
Personally, just put it on a superhero scale for me. That's what I'm basing it off of, is what superhero movies I've encountered. Doesn't have to do anything with the cultural aspect to the movie. I understand that hits home with a lot of other people,
but I also,
who are not a white guy like me, and probably kill some of my credibility, of course, but that's just how I felt. I was just looking at it from a strict superhero movie standpoint. But it was a good movie. Definitely go see it. I would recommend go seeing it in theaters. Yeah. I didn't see it in 3D. I think it would be a pretty cool movie to see in 3D too.
I saw it in 3D.
Was it cool?
It was solid. Yeah. No, the visuals were great. I just wanted more action. I loved the Afro future, like fusion was actually very cool. Overall, 7.
Let's spoil it. So spoilers from here on out, I'll mark this in the show notes. You can come back and listen to our recommendations afterwards. They killed both the villains in this. Andy Serkis gets killed by Killmonger. And later on, Chadwick Boseman kills Michael B. Jordan.
And Killmonger just murders his girlfriend too. Doesn't even care.
Yeah, like he.
That just shows.
That's why that's another point.
Just ruthless. Yeah. I totally forgot that she was even in this movie.
Yes. Same. Cold blooded. Good callback.
Wow, vicious. So I don't think they need to kill either of them. This is Claw's second movie. He's a good villain. He's a semi-big Marvel villain. I guess they don't really show him actually dying, but he takes a couple bullets and. Michael B. Jordan kind of double taps him and puts one in his head, probably.
And he brought him as a offering to get into Wakanda. So he's dead.
Yeah, he's dead. I don't get that. I know that you guys both liked Andy Serkis in this role. I didn't like him as much, but they're both still good characters. Why would you kill the both of them?
I agree. There is still part of me that wants to believe that he still saved Michael B. Jordan at the end, just because he said, I could save you. I could probably save you. He's like, no, don't do it, bro. And he's like, dies.
Yeah, that's so dumb.
But he could just like, oh, I'm going to carry you and fix you right now.
Like, if you're a supervillain, your rationale is never like, I can't live in prison. It's okay, put me in prison and I'll break out of it.
Yep.
It didn't make any sense to me.
What was your favorite technology?
The Black Panther suit.
Besides the Black Panther suit, I guess.
I just like the way that it materialized out of nothing. Came out of the necklace.
What was the whole thing going on with the train? I understand the whole vibranium concept would stop once the train was coming.
You can't, like,
those little flaps would go down. What was going on, though?
It was like stabilizing it or something?
You can't transport vibranium. It can't go faster than a certain speed.
Okay.
So those bars neutralize the Vibranium.
It's not like we haven't said it a million times. Apoplectic.
Oh my God, I'm getting the marks over here. So yeah, it stabilizes it for like the time being.
That makes sense. But they, you know, it's kind of heavy handed the way that they introduce it.
Yeah.
You know, they talk about what powers the train and shit. Yeah, I don't know.
Here. This is actually, I was meaning to ask you guys. One point in the movie, I actually walked out to go to the bathroom. Was one scene I knew it was going to happen, but then I came back in the theater. I was like, I probably missed something. When they were reviving him, I knew he was going to come back.
Too obvious.
Who was there? His mom was there with him, right? And yep. Doing
Angela Bassett.
And the sister was there.
Medical stuff.
The girlfriend was there.
He no longer had the Black Panther powers. Because he was fighting Killmonger and they took it away from him. So the next scene, he's going back to Wakanda and he obviously has those powers.
They revived him.
They revived him and they had some of that potion
shit
on him.
They show Lupita Nyong'o's character. You see her sneak in right before Killmonger says burn all these plants.
There can only be one Black Panther from here on out.
Also, if you have those plants, don't you give that to everybody? We have an army of super soldiers. Doesn't make any fucking sense to me.
You could say that for a lot of things.
Royalty, you got to keep people. Men in power. Yeah.
They don't give their technology to other civilizations.
Kind of a world breaker, though. Yeah. It's just, I don't know.
Yeah, I thought, well, I'm going to get back to my technology. It was definitely the sister having those Mega Man cannon hands. Those were amazing.
She was great in this. Outside of Killmonger, she's my other favorite character.
I would have to agree with you.
She had some lines that were a little cringeworthy, like the "What are those?" line.
That is bad writing, though.
That is bad writing. It wasn't her.
That was bad writing, not her fault. I understand that. I really liked her as a character. I thought when she references the Coachella shit at the end, being in California and how he brought her to Oakland the first time she's been to California, I thought that was pretty funny.
Also, if you see a fucking spaceship in your parking lot, you freak out a little more than, that's kind of cool.
And when the kids are like, oh man, we could chop this up and sell it on eBay.
That was very cringeworthy as well.
I didn't even catch that.
Like he said, like, this is a spaceship Bugatti or something. Like, that's so dumb.
Shit, that's a spaceship Bugatti.
I thought some of the fighting in this was mediocre fine. Or lackluster. They did the shaky cam thing, which is one of my pet peeves.
There was some really bad shaky cam at some of the beginning fights that was bothering me. I was thinking, if I was watching this in 3D, that's another thing why I don't watch 3D movies. Shaky cam is 10 times worse if you're watching it in 3D. You can't focus at all when they're doing the shaky cam.
I just don't get it. It's a Marvel movie. You've got basically an unlimited budget.
Yeah.
You know, get some stuntmen in there. Get some choreographers in there.
Especially when you're doing a fight scene with literally do a full suit on.
Yeah.
You don't have to see the person at all. There was one scene during like the Civil War kind of fighting that they had
at Wakanda between the tribes.
Yeah, you explained this one.
Yeah, so one of my favorite scenes, and it's actually a camera angle scene I've never really seen before, when the rhino bucks him and he's flying through the air and the camera's like just above his shoulder and they're showing him in slow motion approaching this rock and you know he's about to just smash into the rock. I thought that was awesome.
That
do you
was
remember
a very
that
cool
scene,
scene
at all?
I don't. That's surprising that I don't. I guess I should have paid closer attention.
The rhino charges at Black Panther. It's Black Panther. Right?
Yeah.
Hits Black Panther. He's flying through the air and the camera like slows down and it's showing him flying backwards
from
just
like
over
angle,
shoulder.
Like
it's
angle.
A really cool camera angle, which I was that's pretty sweet.
It was. It caught my attention too. I was like, damn, that was actually pretty nice.
That's what sucks is usually I notice stuff like that on the rewatch. So yeah. I do plan on going to see this again. You know, I'll just movie pass in the middle of the week or something. But yeah, that's good call. I was watching, I rewatched Thor earlier this week. There's a scene in the very beginning where he's fighting Surtur and like that army, the lava army.
Mm-hmm.
He throws the hammer and the hammer goes in a circle and the camera is fixed on the hammer.
Yeah.
So you see it kind of spinning around and it's circling around Thor. I thought that was really cool.
Yeah.
That's kind of similar to what we were, that camera angle then.
Gotcha.
Mm-hmm. What'd you think of Wakabi? Daniel
Kaluuya. Yeah. I don't understand why all of a sudden he just turns on Black.
Completely turns.
Lifelong friends.
Exactly.
He wants to see change.
Claw murdered your parents, but you don't just flip like that when some random dude comes to your village and says.
And on your wife.
Yeah.
Too.
I totally forgot about that until the very end when they're talking in the middle of the battle. I'm like, would you kill your love? And she's like, for Wakanda, yes, I will kill you. I totally forgot that they were even married or whatever.
I could see him having trust issues, though.
Would you think of the life-altering moment when Killmonger reveals that he is
his cousin?
His cousin.
It was fine.
Yeah.
It didn't really stand out to me But it was like, okay.
I understand the inner conflict that Black Panther has to T'Challa, because like he gets to go to the afterlife scene, which was really, I like that a lot, because they do that in the comics. He goes to these secret chambers and he goes and talks to his father or the past Black Panthers.
Yeah.
That was really cool, but he gets a chance to confront his dad about it. Mm-hmm. And, you know.
Because he goes back to it.
It's this internal struggle, like right versus wrong. You know, he made the best decision he could at the time, but T'Challa disagrees with it, etc.
This was something that I don't know why it took me out of it, but the dad's eye, like I couldn't stop looking at it for some reason.
Him and not Forrest Whitaker?
Did you see that? Do you see his dead? Literally, he came, like they filmed him after he was exploded in the building. Like an eye was like
I guess I did not notice that.
I looked at it. I was like, oh God. I don't know what it was. I couldn't stop staring at it.
So back to Killmonger's dad, who is in the flashback scenes. He's played by Sterling K. Brown. Did you mention that to Erica at all? Who is big into This Is Us right now. He plays the adopted black son of the family.
I did not know that. I've never watched the show.
Older version of the son.
Okay.
Completely different characters, being a quote unquote Wakandan gangster, I would call him, in the beginning of the movie. And then his character in This Is Us, you'll just have to watch his. He's raised by a white family, so you get the point.
That was weird how he could just immediately drop that Wakandan accent and go, that was crazy. What about the lip tattoos?
Yeah, I was going to mention the lip tattoos.
The way they glow in the dark?
Yeah. Is there vibranium in the lip tattoos?
Probably. Let's talk about the vibranium, because there's a lot of speculation. Obviously, we don't know where the last Infinity Stone is. It's the Soul Stone, which would make sense.
Built into that vibranium, probably the center of the core there.
And it's kind of like how they can go talk to dead people. In these movies, unlike in the comics, they don't really talk about what the stones do. They just say, oh, they're super powerful.
They're going to get into that. They better get into that.
Well, the one that they really do is Doctor Strange's Eye of Agamotto, because it's the time stone. He can, you know, alter time.
Alter time, yeah.
But for the most part, they don't really mention it. So do we think at this point that the Soul Stone is in Wakanda?
Yes, it's going to be one of the last battles in Infinity War.
That makes sense.
Or it's going to be an unfinished battle that ends Infinity War's movie and it gets into the next.
Yeah, well, in the trailer movie for Infinity War, you see warriors, the tribe warriors
running,
like, charging.
Yeah.
So they could be defending against Thanos and his minions.
I did like how they explained it in the very beginning, like how this vibranium landed in Africa and causing all its vegetation to be like fucked. So yeah, it gave Africa a reason to have shitty vegetation. It kind of just like played into the world, at least. It made sense. So I could see that definitely being like the last part. It's just like buried in the middle of it. Soul Stone.
I thought for sure that it was going to be in space with Adam Warlock, like we saw at the end of Guardians 2, but.
Did you like the whole relationship with Black Panther and his ex-girlfriend? You don't really get much detail around that.
I could care less.
You know, she's his ex-girlfriend, and at the end, he just kisses her because he almost died, he says.
I did not care for her character.
It was very forgetful, but at the same time, at the end, when they rekindled their love, I completely forgot they even had a relationship.
Yeah.
That's the relationships in here were shaky at best. Like, we forgot the two before that. I can't even remember the names. That's it.
Oh, okay. So you're going somewhere with that, but okay, fair enough.
Done.
So I read some interviews with Ryan Coogler, and he talked about the Infinity Stone not being in it. He said, well, we don't really need that because we have vibranium. And he also mentioned he wanted to get Kraven the Hunter in this. One of the most famous...
From Spider-Man?
Yeah, one of the most famous Spider-Man stories is Kraven's Last Hunt, in which Kraven hunts Spider-Man.
That would be sweet.
Which, it's a great story. But unfortunately, Marvel doesn't own the rights because Sony has Spider-Man. And technically he debuted in Spider-Man, which really sucks. I don't remember what I was going with that, but cool.
Spider-Man. I love Spider-Man.
Let's talk about the post-credit scenes. The mid-credit scene is T'Challa delivering a very powerful speech about uniting people and not building walls, but building bridges.
They probably could have ended the movie with that.
Yeah, it doesn't make any sense to have that after part of the credits. It was well acted.
The reason I say that, though, is because a lot of people still leave the movie theater once the movie ends and they don't wait for the credits all the time. And that was a powerful scene, I would say. And I think, though,
if you do that, I don't feel bad for you.
Yeah.
It's a Marvel movie. You know there's going to be a credit scene.
A lot of those people are leaving because they know they're just going to YouTube the scenes later on, you know. Yeah. But still, I think it could have potentially been a good movie ending scene.
Sure. Pretty much a direct shot at Donald Trump in there.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
About building walls and you should be building bridges instead. But I thought the more interesting scene that obviously adds something to the universe is the very end with post-credits where you see Bucky Barnes and they call him the White Wolf. The White Wolf is an actual character that is friends with T'Challa in the comic books, but it's not Bucky Barnes.
Yeah.
It's a guy that gets in a plane crash and he kind of like is raised in the African nation and shit like that. But it was good to see Bucky. That was really one of the only connections to the outside world in this, besides Martin Freeman.
Is that where he gets his... No, he doesn't get his arm.
He's going to get his arm.
He's going to get a Vibranium arm?
And Letitia Wright is going to build it for him, obviously.
He's going to get a Mega Man Vibranium arm. Amazing.
He's going to slay.
Going to be sick. And you see him in the trailer for Infinity War, and he has two arms. So,
sick.
I think he does.
Not going to not give him an arm.
I don't have anything else to say about this.
I liked it. I recommend the movie. Go see it in theaters.
Download the soundtrack.
The soundtrack is awesome.
Really good.
That is another thing. I wish there was more Kendrick Lamar. They had him in there, but there was some score in the background, just a basic score. But that scene, if they would have threw in like a Kendrick Lamar pump up song as that whole tribe fight was happening in Wakanda, that would have been
that would have been actually awesome.
That would have been awesome.
Yeah, missed opportunity there.
I don't know what it is. A lot of movies nowadays, I'm hearing all these soundtracks and what the movies are doing. And then I'm seeing trailers and they have awesome soundtrack in the background. And then I go see the movie and there's one or two songs that are part of the actual movie soundtrack. But I'm just expecting a lot more. And I thought they were going to use a lot more like hip hop type songs and songs like that in the movie. And they really didn't. They had a couple Kendrick Lamar
in the trailer. They use that Run the Jewels song. And that's not in the movie at all. But this, again, and I hate to benchmark it against Thor, but the ending scene or even the beginning scene where they play the Immigrant Song, the Led Zeppelin song, gets you so jacked up.
It does.
That's missed opportunity.
But they definitely missed that opportunity.
That's Black Panther. We all liked it. Go see it.
Yeah.
Let's do some recommendations for the week. Are you going to recommend like a shovel to me or something?
I'll go first. We have C2E2 coming up in the first week of April. April.
Is the first week? Fuck. They move it up every year.
Right.
April 6th through the 8th. But if you want to take it, you can go. You can either obviously get one there or go to your local comic shop and pick one up. That's what I recommend.
Yeah.
So then you're also supporting local comic shops.
So we have C2E2 April 6th through the 8th. We're going to be there this year. We're going to potentially most likely be doing some interviews, a recap video, and we're looking forward to it. I have a different cosplay outfit this time other than Batman. I will be wearing Batman one of the days. I don't know which day.
Probably the coldest.
It's going to be a good time. If you haven't been, there's a lot of big guests this year, especially, I would mention this to Erica, you have, I believe, two guests from This Is Us, one being the good-looking brother she would know who I'm talking about, and then one being the main dad who passes away and makes everyone cry. You have some great guests, a great lineup. If you read comics, you have some great artists. Other than that, I would definitely recommend going to C2E2 this year. April 6th through April 8th.
Rick, you got anything for me?
Kingdom Come Deliverance just released.
Oh, a video game?
Yeah. It's like a knight's tale without any magic or anything. It's just like a pure fighting. You're like a BAMF. You just run around and do an RPG.
Didn't they just do something like that?
For Honor.
That's more of like a PvP. This is more of just an RPG running around in this world, like a knight. Kind of like Skyrim, but just like more, more no magic and no shit. Magic. It's all battling and you're just like bamping
dragons.
People. And it, no, it's all real.
Okay.
Like in that era.
Wait, dragons are real.
They
real.
Keep it authentic. And then, your appearance like matters. You have to like keep your, like what you're wearing will get dirty and bloody and shit. And then people will act.
They won't let you in the brothel with blood all over your shirt.
Yeah. They'll be like, all right, you're talking to a lord and you're scruffy. They're like, all right, I'm going to look down upon you because you don't bathe. So they get like really deep into the RPG. Came out February 13th. I don't know. So
sounds terrible.
Check it out.
Where do you know this from? You just watched trailers?
It's one of the big AAA. Right, it's one of the AAA big releases that like come every couple of quarters.
Speaking of conventions, are you going to E3? What is it? E3? What is it?
No.
What is the gaming convention?
We should go to E3, though. We should try and get press passes for E3. That'd be boss.
0% chance. They'll look at us just like C2E2 does.
Yeah.
Worst man alive, C2E2, for not giving us press passes. But anyways, my recommendation for the week is one, Kung Fury, which I won't get into again. But two, a new podcast I just started listening to called A Very Fatal Murder from the people at The Onion. Essentially a true crime satire. And it follows the story of our, I guess, host, who is looking for the best murder to start a podcast about. So think Serial, but it's someone who only is doing it for the notoriety or to make money.
Okay.
For instance, he finds this murder and he goes and visits the parents and the parents are like sobbing and he makes one of them do an ad read for his podcast. It's very funny and it's from the people at The Onion. So obviously, you know, it has a pedigree. So go check that out.
Sounds hilarious. I think we're good. Rick, you got anything else? No, peace. All right.
Well, no peace, I'm the best.
Catch us on all social media platforms, Instagram, Facebook, at The ChumpCast. Go to our www.thechumpcast.com website. Chumps out, motherfucker.